Hi, welcome to Raumfeld Listening Room. This is the first time we do this here in Berlin. My name is Pablo La Rosa. I'm the general manager marketing for Raumfeld here in the Teufel Raumfeld store. Thank you all for coming. We're very excited to preview for you tonight the new White Lies album, Friends. So you all are going to be the first people, actually I think in the world, who get to hear this album before the release on Friday. So you are really special guests for us tonight. So thank you for coming. Quickly, a word just about why we're here. What does Raumfeld and White Lies have to do with each other? So Raumfeld, in case you weren't familiar, we are part of Lautsprecher Teufel here in Berlin. And we are making wireless streaming speakers. So if you want to play music in your home from Spotify, from SoundCloud, from all the popular streaming services and channels, you can do that through Raumfeld speakers. And we make speakers from every size and budget. So you can start with small systems all the way up to very large systems like these. They're very, very high fidelity. They're very, very nicely designed. They sound amazing. The White Lies guys actually love these speakers and listen to their music in the home with Raumfeld. That's why we got together today, and we want to talk about listening, the art of listening, in fact. So I don't know about you guys, but when I was a kid, I used to listen to albums, really, I made it a ritual. I would take the record out, I would put it on the turntable, or later in the late 80s, a CD, I would put it on, and I would sit down in front of the stereo, and I would really listen to an album from start to finish, you know, beginning to end. I would pay attention to everything about the song, and really soak it in, and get to know the music. And I think today, with all these gadgets that we have, our phones, our tablets, everything else, I think we've sort of lost touch with the art of listening because we're so distracted by technology. You know, you try to listen to a record and then you get a text, or you go on Facebook and you check something, or your Instagram, and you're not really paying attention. And at Raumfeld, we want to bring back this active listening. We want people to really enjoy music the way it was intended, to sit down in front of a nice stereo system. And you know, if you're listening on a small Bluetooth speaker, I'm sure if you're aware or not, but you're actually listening to music in mono. I mean, would you watch TV in black and white? I guess not, but you listen in mono. So we want you to listen in stereo. We want you to hear the music properly, the way the artist intended, and really make time for music, because when you do that, it actually improves the quality of your life. And that's actually what we want to do here at Raumfeld, is improve the quality of your life. So the White Lies guys are here. We've just had an excellent dinner. We've just had some Japanese dinner, a little bit of sake, a little beer. So yeah, we feel pretty good right now. Let's put it that way. Yeah. So they're going to come on stage here and join me in just a minute. And what we're going to do tonight, we're going to listen to the new album, Friends. There's 10 tracks on the album on Friends. And I think some of you, if you're really hardcore White Lies fans, you might have heard a few of the tracks that they released already on Spotify and on Apple Music. But we are going to listen to the entire album beginning to end. And we're going to talk to the guys about each track as we listen to it. And they're going to kind of guide you through this album, tell you what to listen for, tell you a little bit about what went into every song, what was the thought process, what was the recording like, what should you pay attention to when you listen. So we'll listen to each track, and we'll go through the whole album, and then after that, then we're going to sit down, and we're going to give you guys the opportunity to ask White Lies your own questions and have them answered here, right here on the stage. And then you definitely want to stick around, because White Lies are going to do a DJ set right here on this stage. We're going to kick these chairs out. We're going to bring the DJ booth up. And you guys can continue to drink all you want and have a great time and dance to a White Lies DJ set. So really happy that you're here. And at this time, I would like to bring to the stage White Lies. So let's welcome to the stage Charles Cave, Jack Lawrence Brown, and Harry McVeigh. Gentlemen, have a seat. So, you know, it's funny because we stand here on stage and all I see are bright lights in my face. I can't really see anybody. It's very strange, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, we're used to that.
You're used to that. Okay. Yeah, that's right. You're performers. I'm just a marketing guy. What do I know? So what we want to do is, I want to start the conversation quickly by talking a little bit about your new album, Friends. It's your fourth studio album, so this is, we talked about this before when I was in London with you guys. It's a bit of an achievement, I guess, to hit four albums, kind of like a magic number. A lot of bands, you know, they release one, and then if they're successful, maybe they get to release a second album, and oftentimes that's kind of where it's make it or break it, and you guys are on your fourth, so that's a pretty great achievement. So tell me about how that feels, and tell me a little bit about, you know, the preparation that went into the writing and recording of this album.
Hello, everyone. It's great to be here.
Right.
Thank you so much for joining us. We definitely feel like we have a proper body of work now, and that we have a real career as a band. And I think that we're perhaps more entitled to feel that on our fourth than we were on any of our other records. And also, this will be the album that we reach 10 years on. I think in a couple of years' time, we'll have been together as a band for 10 years, which is another milestone, and it's amazing. I think we just feel very pleased that we've been given the opportunity to reach this point, and I feel we've learned a lot from the three records we made already. I think we're still moving forwards. I think we're still writing things that are very new for us and very new for our fans, hopefully, and kind of move our music onwards and into new directions. And that was definitely something we were aiming for when we were writing and recording this album.
I definitely agree.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
That was a good intro. Man.
So, you guys obviously have quite a nice fan base here in Germany. So, you've played quite a lot of shows in Germany, actually. And when was the last time you were in Berlin?
We were in Berlin very recently. Harry and I very much like being in Berlin for the number one reason of visiting the Liquid Room Spa.
Liquid Room.
Don't know if you guys know that place, but It's very rare that you get to get fully naked with your best friend in London. They sort of turn a blind, they sort of frown upon that. And then here in Germany, you embrace that kind of relationship and friendship. We did a bit of that today as well, actually. That's what being in a band is mostly about, is getting intimate in saunas and steam rooms. But we've always had really good shows in Germany. I think the first one I remember most was was Halden. Is that a festival here?
Yeah,
Halden Pop with a lake, with famously where the singer of the Cardigans, just to bring it back to nudity, apparently spun naked once. Yeah. There's a festival in Germany. It's a good one. But we've been so many times, and every time seem to get more fans, which is I think the record label would tell us that's good. It's good to increase fans, I think. So it's going
marketing
well.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, I mean, you've had a little bit of time off between the last tour and this record, I guess a couple of years, if I'm not mistaken, right? So how did you use the time, and how did this time off maybe influence a little bit the direction of this album?
Well, we did. It wasn't that much time off. I mean, we were touring for a very long time. We've been asked that a few times. People said, you know, it's been so long, like, what have you been doing? We did go on an extensive world tour for a kind of 2 years, but we did a lot of playing, and I think we finished the tour of Big TV playing better than we've ever played before, definitely. And so we chose that moment to actually not do anything and relax for a long time. But just take a few months off. Everyone got hobbies, and I don't know. Jack tried to learn Japanese.
Jack was learning Japanese, yeah. Right? Yeah.
Well, I think as well that that time off, that 6 months, did have an impact on the writing of this record. Like, we really, when we came to the end of that, we were really hungry to be creative again and to start writing again, and also we knew that we didn't have a record deal at that point, and that we needed to make that happen, and that definitely informed when we started writing again, because we knew that we had to really craft a bunch of songs to quite a high degree, perhaps more so than we'd ever done in the past with our demos. Like, we had to make things sound like at least give people an idea of what they'd sound like when they were finished. Whereas before, when we've demoed in the past, on all of our three albums, we've always only demoed songs to a very low standard, very roughly. So only we know how they're going to sound. But I think that time off and coming back hungry to get the deal again was very important. And it was definitely informed the songs on the record.
Yeah, and you guys actually self-produced this album for the most part, if I'm not mistaken, right? So that was also a change for you, right? To take more control over how your sound was going to be in the end.
We did, sort of out of necessity. We had an engineer that we really wanted to work with, James Brown, who worked on the first 2 weeks of the recording sessions in Olympia Studios. And
Brian Ferry's studio, Brian Ferry's studio, people are not familiar. Amazing place.
Yeah, and that kind of forced our hand because we really wanted to work with him, but he only had these 2 weeks available, so we knew we had to kind of piece together the record with other people after that. But that was a really interesting part of the process. I think you can really hear that on this record. There's a lot of variance between. Well, you'll hear it now when we play the songs out. But there's a lot of variance between the songs. A lot of the songs are very different from each other, and that wouldn't have come about without working with these different people in different places, and that was shaped purely by that decision out of necessity, because we knew we didn't have James Brown for more than 2 weeks, basically.
Jack, you mentioned before that on this record there's a lot more of the electronic side of White Lies than the guitar-focused side of White Lies that we may have heard in past albums, and that had to do with the fact that you were really in control of the direction of the album this time. You didn't have to answer to anyone, that you could basically do the songs the way that you felt that they should be done and to their logical conclusion, I think was the way you put it. So, yeah.
Just wait for that pass.
Yeah. Sirens. We had sirens at your place too, and now they're here. They follow us everywhere.
Yeah, so with the guitar stuff, I mean, maybe that's more for Harry to say, but from my point of view, I feel like when there's no necessity or when there's no feeling like we have to include, there's no reason to make Friends a guitar-based record, and then actually maybe the guitar parts that Harry's ended up coming up with and playing are way more interesting and exciting because they're not there to sort of boost a chorus. They're not there to sort of give everyone a big payoff. One or two songs, we've done that. But in general, when the guitar comes in, it feels like a moment. And I think it's easy if you're a rock band to slip into the practice of plastering your choruses with big guitars, because that's what rock bands do, and it makes your song sound like a big rock song. We weren't really worried about making rock songs on this album. There's one or two moments when we've gone down that route, but then in other places, I think Harry's allowed maybe his other influences to come through, which are nothing to do with rock music. Mm. And in fact, for my money, more interesting and more exciting to listen to.
Definitely. What were your influences going into this album? I mean, I guess you guys spent a lot of time listening to music and absorbing things and talking about things. What would you say influenced you when you approached this?
Well, we listened to so much music. And a big part of the writing process, Charles and I spent about 2 hours every morning, sometimes more, listening to music and nothing else, just drinking coffee and listening to music. And that was always to find a moment in a song or a piece of music that we really liked, that we found really inspiring, and then to try and flesh a song or flesh our own material out of that. But I think the big influences on the record, more specifically, are bands like Steely Dan, a band that Charles has been listening to a very long time, but I really kind of fell in love with during the writing of this album. And I think you can hear that on a few songs, especially the last track, actually, on the record, Don't Fall, which is a huge Steely Dan influence. Mm-hmm. I think talking more specifically about guitars, I listened to a lot of Shuggy Otis as well, which is, I mean, he's a phenomenal guitar player, phenomenal musician. And some of his guitar playing really affected songs like Hold Back Your Love. There's a really amazing sort of guitar sequence in a lot of that song, which is heavily inspired by Shuggy Otis. But as I said, there's hundreds and hundreds of different bands and artists that we listened to while we were writing the album.
Mm. We usually name the songs after what we're sort of stealing in the first point.
Okay.
So we have this list of songs on iTunes of ideas that are named like Michael Jackson song and Metallica song.
All right.
Yeah. Lacuna Coil song. And then we just, and then they disappear. You know, you keep yeah. Sorry, that was cool. You keep working on them, and they keep changing and changing and changing. And then Harry's filing system for music is pretty atrocious. I sort of say to Harry, can we work on that thing, you know, the Michael Jackson thing or whatever it was from a week ago? And he's like, okay, well, what date was that? What's it called? I think it's now called Stupid Tuesday Thing 0314, you know, version 9. It's like, okay.
Right.
So,
it's part of the fun.
To be honest with you, we've probably, I think, just through bad filing, lost 20 or 30 songs in the process of writing it.
But that's the thing, you wrote something like 30 songs, right, before recording this album, is that correct?
Yeah, it probably was about that much.
30 songs.
There's quite a few, we've actually released quite a few of them on the special edition version of the book. Because it's hard, I think 10 tracks is even pushing it for me on an album. I like albums short and sweet. And I think
it's hard to make the call, like what makes the album and what doesn't, right?
It's really difficult. And I think there was talk. I think we're going to play maybe one or two of the other ones. We'll see.
At the start of the DJ set.
At the start of the DJ set, or something like that.
So you have to stay for the DJ set because you're going to hear some, you know, unreleased material.
Some B-sides.
Yeah. Great. So as far as like recording this album goes, were there? You guys worked together, I guess, in London, right? You sat together and wrote every day, and then you went in the studio. You recorded something like 30 songs. Would you say this album has like a different concept than previous albums? Like, I feel like, you know, when you start with your earliest works, let's face it, it's a little bit depressing, right? And I like that actually. It's a dark kind of, you know, and it. I mean, there's a lot of bands that have made that work for them, and I think you did it as well. You know, it's cool. I love it. But on this album, I mean, having heard it myself, I feel like it's a little bit more uplifting at times, and maybe, a little more like just positive and overall. And would you agree, or was there a different feeling overall when you went into this album?
I think that all of our albums have got kind of light and shade on them, but I think that perhaps it's just a case of subtlety, really. Mm. And you know, we still love our first record, and we know it's obviously a very important record for our fans, and it's many people's favorite of ours, and that's totally fine. But I think that we were talking the other day is that there's no way we'll ever make another record like that. It's very much an 18-year-old, 19-year-old record. We're just finished secondary school, high school, and you know, you're still full of the kind of early influences that you have from teenage bands that you listen to. In terms of lyrics and stuff, you've still got all kind of slightly dodgy GCSE poetry, you know, floating around in you. And I think it'd be quite worrying, actually, if a 28-year-old came out with our first album. Mm. I think,
So you grow, and the songs grow with you in a way.
Yeah, but
right?
you don't really make an effort to grow. It just sort of happens. I mean, there's never been an album or a song that we've even sat down and gone, you know, it's really important that this one is like a development of or something like that. We just have always sat down and written, and there's no set way that it happens. Mm. We wrote the second album in like 6 weeks, and then this one it took a year. Mm. The most important thing is that I think the more Harry and I write songs, the more we enjoy doing it, and the more that's why we wrote 30 or whatever for this one, but not because we felt like we had to or because we didn't have any good enough ones. It was just really enjoyable. It's sure. Probably the most enjoyable part of. You know, part of making an album is those initial writing sessions.
And the really great thing is now, I mean, you're preparing for your live show. I guess this tour is kicking off kind of tomorrow, or if I get that right, in London. Yeah.
We have a show in London tomorrow.
Yeah. So the tour kicks off tomorrow. So you're kind of preparing your live show, and now, and you'll be in Berlin later this month at Huxley's. So everybody, welcome to come.
Yeah. More than welcome, actually. Please do come.
Please come. Please support.
Yeah. So much welcome.
But your show has changed quite a lot now that you have really quite a catalog of material to choose from, because I think, when you first started, you know, I think you were telling me, you know, you could barely do a 30-minute, you know, show or something like that. And now you have like 4 albums worth of material, and you have to decide, what are we going to play tonight? How are we going to please the fans, and how are we going to, you know, please ourselves? And
do you know what? We literally, we literally look at the most popular songs on Spotify, and we
Spotify, and we
directly ask our fans what songs should we play, and then we just do that.
Is that true?
Yeah, because there's nothing worse than going to a gig and bands just playing.
So what do you guys want? What would you guys want to hear in the crowd?
They've done it on Twitter. You know, we've got all the we've got metadata. We've got pie charts.
Okay.
We know that Italy prefer this song.
The nerds are working on it.
Seriously,
let's put it that way.
We're all wired up, getting told like quickly. Everyone's in the bad mood for that song. Don't do that one.
All right.
No, but we, like I was just saying about the first album, like we never want to be one of those bands that that sort of abandon early material just because it's old. Like I think that's a ridiculous reason to stop playing it. We'll always play.
So you never get tired of playing your own songs?
Not really. Yeah. You create. If you do get a little bit kind of too autopilot about it, you can create mind games to keep yourself really entertained.
Shopping lists.
Yeah, you can say to yourself, I have to come up with like a 3-course dinner whilst in the entire duration of playing this song, like in my head. And that's when it starts to get really risky. That's when I make mistakes.
Okay. So, I guess everybody knows the guys here, Charles. He's, you know, in the live show, you're playing bass mostly. Harry's doing vocals and guitar, and Jack is the drummer. And there's a keyboardist who's also joining you guys on the tour, I guess, as well.
Yeah.
So I think at this point, it's a good time to start listening to the album. What do you guys say? Shall we start listening? Are you ready to listen? Come on, give it up for White Lies.
Yeah.
We're
starting with a huge
We're going to listen in order. Don't worry.
It's going to be quite tedious because the first three are already released, actually.
That's true, but you know what? You can still... But the point is, we want you guys to tell us a little bit about each song and to tell us what to listen for, and you can still set this up in a nice way. And I mean, for me, when I heard Take It Out on Me, I was really... It felt like a White Lies song, you know? I mean, it felt like... you know, the typical kind of like really chugging bass line that's on the, you know, the eighth notes, very up-tempo, very rocking, the guitars come in, it feels like White Lies.
And I think that's why we wanted to release it as the first single, because we've been away for a little while, and we wanted to come back with a song that was very much in the sort of spirit and the vein of White Lies. And that's also why we wanted to open the album with it. It definitely touches upon a lot.
Was this one of the first songs you recorded, or...?
No, I don't think it was, actually. And it certainly wasn't one of the first songs we wrote. It was sort of towards the end of the writing sessions, actually. But, it didn't really shape the record. And actually, it wasn't really a contender for single until very late on in the process. We already had the whole record done, and we were talking about the track list as a whole, and this kind of came up very late on. But we all felt that it's a great introduction to the record.
Any other interesting anecdotes that you recall from the recording or the writing of this tune, gentlemen?
I think there will be.
I think we should start
playing music.
All right, let's play.
I think our voices are a bit tedious, really.
Here we go. This is Take It Out on Me. And that means we get to drink, right? What do you guys think? Is that a good start to the album? Yeah, right?
We love fading out songs.
I know. It's just like...
Oh, it's so much fun.
But the breakdown in that song was kind of unexpected, right? I mean, it's chugging along, and then all of a sudden there's this like DX piano, and it just melts for a minute, right?
We were really told off, actually, for that piano. There's a producer that we worked with on two of our records before, the first and the third, Ed Buller, who is a great friend of ours, and still is. He really told us off for that keyboard sound because it's sort of a no-go in the world of production. It's incredibly cheesy. It's like it's instant REO Speedwagon, I think. But we made it work. We made it work, but also, maybe not. But we genuinely listened to a lot of REO Speedwagon and that kind of music when we were writing the album. And I think that's a slight homage to that. Like it's the only element of the album that we kind of really tip the hat to that kind of music, and I think we got away with it. Just so, yeah.
Okay. So let's move on to track two. This one is called Morning in L.A. I mean, a few things I picked up on this track. Number one, with Jack's work on it, the offbeats on the stick noise, you know, you really hear that if you pay attention. I picked that up. Of course, the guitars at the end start really rocking. There's this really intense buildup towards the end with the vocal. So I think that's definitely something you should check out when we listen to this track. Maybe some thoughts about this one.
I think this one was probably one of the tracks that changed more between the demo and the studio. I have a distinct memory in the studio of Harry suggesting that I pilfer the drum beat from Beat It by Michael Jackson, which I did. And
so you weren't kidding when you said Michael Jackson.
And that song changed from being a sort of a way more jangly, kind of like Smithsy type song to being actually a pretty full-on stab at doing a pop song. And we do that sort of once an album. We'll do like a really sort of poppy song, maybe more than once on this record. But it's the lyric is so immediately catchy, and there's a hook and a melody line that you sort of would waste if you did anything with it except try and make it something to stick in people's minds. Mm. And it's one of those lyrics that you sort of, I don't know, maybe Charles often aims for or not, but where it's just, it feels very simple, but at the same time, it maybe captures everyone's imagination.
Right. So, Morning in LA, but nobody lives in LA. You live in San Francisco. You guys still live in London. So, what's the meaning behind this song? Tell me.
Well, I was about to say, having moved to San Francisco very recently, about 4 or 5 months ago, I really felt a new connection with this song. Because for me, the chorus is very much about trying to get in touch with people who are on completely different time zones to yourself. And I always make the mistake of calling people at like 4 o'clock in the morning and without realizing what time they've gone to bed. So I actually I love this song for that reason. I feel like I've connected with it much more having made that move, and it really resonates with me. I love performing it.
Hmm.
Yep. I think on a side note that it's very likely that that our friend Max, who this song is sort of kind of based around, because he's the bastard that moved to LA from London, left us all. I think he's watching now. So if he is...
Hi, Max.
You're a dickhead. I think we should listen to
him. Yeah, right. I used to live in LA for a while. I mean, yeah.
It's okay.
It's okay. It's not a bad... I mean, the weather's pretty predictable. It's the same thing every day. It's 7 degrees and sunny in LA, and there's lots of traffic and smog, right? Yeah. That's about it. So, with that said, let's listen to track two from the album called Morning in LA. Are you ready? Here we go. Yeah. Okay. You guys like that, right? I actually like this next song. Really, it's one of my favorites on the album, I have to say. It's called Hold Back Your Love. I think it's been released already a little bit on Spotify. So if you're hardcore White Lies fans, you've probably heard it. But I really love this song. It sticks in my head. It's got such a good chorus. And for me, like, this one was a bit different because it's very synth-driven, right? You have, interestingly, I mean, you're the bass player, but you have synth bass, and then you have electric bass kind of going on at the same time, and you had to, like, make these two elements work together on the track so that you hear them both. And it works, actually. It works really well. Great chorus, drums, offbeat. It kind of reminds me a little bit of a track on the last album, this kind of, like, paradiddle? I mean, paradiddle, exactly. Ah, see? I know my drummer terms. Yeah, so I kind of picked that up. Maybe there's some things you want to share about it, but for me, this is really one of my favorites on the album, I have to say.
I think when we've spoken about the album as a whole, we've often talked about how there's a lot of variance in the songs. There's a lot of songs that are quite different, and I think this is one of them. Before we went into the sessions to write and record this album, we played a few shows that were sort of like private or corporate gigs, but they were full of people who didn't know our songs at all. And we really felt that we needed some songs that people could dance to, that people could actually move to. And this was one of the songs that emerged out of that thinking. This and Is My Love Enough, which you'll hear later, especially. So this has like a really great kind of almost disco groove to it, I think, in certain points.
Definitely.
And earlier I was talking about Shuggy Otis and the great Shuggy Otis guitar parts and sort of guitar sequences that he puts in his tracks. And that is a huge influence on the guitars in this song, especially in the outro and the sort of post-chorus sections. And that was really good fun, and I love that sound. And it's something we've never done before, and I feel very proud of that. And I think it's a great sort of moment on the record.
Mm. Okay.
What I was going to say is also the verses of this song sort of, I think, reference quite heavily probably White Lies' all-time favourite band as a group. Which is Talking Heads, and that was the first song White Lies learnt to play when we were 15 years old, when we weren't called White Lies, was Psycho Killer, a really appalling version of Psycho Killer. And I think this song's verse has the same sort of basic stomp to it that a lot of really great Talking Head tracks have.
All right, shall we hear it? So let's listen to Hold Back Your Love again. Love this track, so feel free to dance if you want. Okay, that was Hold Back Your Love. Give it up. That was a good song. I like it. Is it, what's that? But the next song you really like, right? This one is called Don't Want to Feel It All. And this is one you've not heard, because the first three songs, if you've been paying attention to White Lies catalog, you've probably maybe heard those three. But the rest of these you're not going to know. And so it's going to be a little surprise. I think this next song called Don't Want to Feel It All, it's very mellow at times, but then it surprises you and it gets very hardcore and then it goes back to mellow. So you kind of like, you're walking these two lines between like almost like a tropical house kind of feeling.
Yeah, and then, it has a very White Lies moment in the middle section of this song. And
exactly.
I think that's the sort of the White Lies moment in this track, but the rest of it is quite different to anything we've done before.
For sure.
Yeah, it's I don't know. It's kind of like a great kind of feel good. I think it almost has a ballad tempo to it. Actually, it's quite slow tempo wise, and it's, I think it's just like kind of a great pop song, great pop moment on the record. We did think about this song very. Very seriously as a single contender, and it may well be in the future. Who knows? But actually, you're a big fan of this track, aren't you, Charles?
Yeah.
Maybe you should say a few words about it.
I do like this one. This one is, I think, there's, you know, all of the records we've released have things that tie them all together, and that perhaps some songs could be interchangeable. You know, there's some songs on this record that perhaps recorded slightly differently could have been on the first record and all that. But this one, I think, is very unique to this record, and I can't really imagine it on any of the others. I think it'll probably end up splitting opinion, actually. I think, you know, it's quite... Half the people in here might walk out, and half might stay.
But you guys aren't going to walk out.
But we'll collect that data, and that will inform
what you play in your live
whether
show,
whether or not
right?
we decide to play it live.
Exactly. Okay. So this is like on the radio. We're on the radio. It's Smash or Trash.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
We should give everyone buzzers. Give
exactly.
Everyone sort of,
okay. Yeah. So we're going to listen to this one called "Don't Want to Feel It All." And then we're going to see what you guys think afterwards. Should they play it live or should they just put it in the B-sides? No, okay. No, really. Here we go. Enjoy this one. Was that you playing the keyboard? Was it you? Was you? Was the prophet?
You said your mind was changing. I wasn't.
Yes, hello. What do you think, guys? Yeah? Yeah? All right. Ooh, what?
That's like being the Beatles.
Yeah.
Okay, right now is a good time for everyone to take a break and grab a beer because we finished ours and everyone else needs to drink too.
Because we've already replenished.
Yeah, exactly. So if you don't have a beer, please go and get yourself one right now. Right now, because we want you to... We can't party if you're not partying along with us. So, the next track actually is a very good track to party to. It's called Is My Love Enough? It has a very electronic feel, a lot of synth bass. We have some... I picked up some really interesting tape delay effects. Maybe am I right? Was it a tape delay? Was it a...
It was probably artificial tape delay, yeah.
But it was a tape delay. Yeah. On the drums, specifically, you have this, like... Later on in the song, there's like this delay effect on the drums. It's kind of like knocking.
Like a helicopter.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. I picked that up. There's this arpeggio that's kind of going throughout the tune from the beginning to the end that kind of holds it all together in a way. Yeah. Tell me about this one.
I think this song is well, we talked earlier about Hold Back Your Love being a bit of a departure from the kind of stuff we've done before. This track is also along those lines. It's very much rooted in kind of 70s, 80s disco. Mm. And this is a song that we kind of wrote with people dancing to it in mind, I think.
Yeah,
and,
absolutely.
And I'm not
if you
sure
don't dance when we play this...
Well, I mean, I don't dance to anything myself personally. But
no, DJs don't dance.
No. I feel very proud of this song. I really like it. I think it's very simple in a lot of ways, but it's simple in a very direct way. Like it kind of distills what I think of as great melody, and it's very hard. It's very easy to access. But I think we agonize a lot over it, and we really try to perfect this song, and really try to get to the essence of what makes up great sort of pop melody with this track. And I hope that comes across.
Gentlemen, other thoughts?
It's very, very enjoyable to play this one. I think I suppose being a little bit perhaps OCD about music when we get into the live show and stuff, I tend to get the most satisfaction. I'm enjoying it, so I could take it. I quite like holding it.
Right.
I get a lot of satisfaction out of when certain songs that really require being extremely tight for them to kind of work and not sound sloppy and this one we've just been rehearsing last week for 10 days or something, and
okay,
I think we all knew that this one would be very tricky to nail, and by the end of it when it was sounding really good, it's just so satisfying. It makes you almost for just a split second feel like a professional musician.
Yeah, but you guys are all self-taught from what I understand, right?
Is that true?
Is that true? Nobody took any music lessons here? You're all like...
I did a lot of music classes when I was young, but I never learned how... I was never taught how to play the guitar.
Okay.
I think we all dabbled in music at school.
Yeah.
And I think that probably informed a lot of how we approached playing. Yeah. But we definitely taught ourselves how to play our respective instruments in the band.
Mm. Cool. Let's listen to it. This is... Is My Love Enough? I like this song too. It reminds me a little bit of LCD Sound System, I have to say, but it's in a good way. I love it. I hope you like it too. And again, drink and dance. Is My Love Enough? You guys like that one? I like that track quite a lot. Thank you. Right. How are you feeling, Harry?
I'm feeling much better. It's turning into quite a desperate situation. I had to take action.
Okay.
But I feel much better now, yeah.
Good. What happens when you're actually on a show and playing? Then what? You can't really just duck out, can
you?
Just
piss yourself. Right. It's much easier if you're the drummer.
Right.
The drums are hiding it.
So, speaking of shows, this next track, actually, when I heard it, I was like, this is the festival track. This is the one you play when you play the big shows.
Yes.
Yeah, it's called Summer Didn't Change a Thing. It really sounds like classic, you know, vintage White Lies, if you will.
Yeah.
But it's the crowd pleaser. It's the one that everybody's going to, like, really enjoy in the big outdoor arena setting. Am I right?
Yeah, this song has its big rock moments, and that's, I think that's something we really pushed, especially in the choruses when we were recording this track. We went for quite a big drum sound, quite a big guitar sound, and kind of doubled everything up. I think in this song we did something quite typical of some of the songs that people really love of White Lies' music, which is we took a chorus and we repeated it over and over again. And we tried to make, especially at the end of the song, we tried to make it bigger and bigger each time, which is definitely...
And how did you do that? Like, what was
just
the...
Just add more stuff. Well, I think we've got
48
better...
tracks?
I think we've got better at doing that, actually, on this record. Like, so you don't necessarily add more parts, but you add more to the parts that you're playing, if that makes sense.
More intensity.
Yeah, more intensity. Because previously, and especially on our second record, I think, we had a tendency to layer up every sound with like 20 or 30 instruments playing the same thing, kind of thing, to try and make it bigger. Whereas on this song in particular, I think, for me personally, I really hear how the parts progress as individual parts, and that adds to the sound and makes it bigger, rather than just adding more and more instruments playing the same thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, I love this track. I think it's great. And I think it has a lot of some kind of great 80s rock influences in the verses.
Definitely.
As well. And the verses are very different from the chorus, which is kind of fun.
Yeah, I agree. I really like the stark contrast between the verse and the chorus. The verse feels extremely light, I think, for us, and the chorus is definitely on the heavier side. And I think I think our song Bigger Than Us from our second record is such a kind of, it's still one that we really, really enjoy. And every time I don't hear it on the radio very much at all, but every time I go out.
Unless you listen to White Lies Radio on Spotify, right?
Every time I go out of my way to listen to our own music and I hear that song, I think how fluky we were at writing a really, really big kind of dramatic chorus like that. In that kind of, sort of half-time feel, and this chorus is definitely the most similar thing I think we've got to that.
Mm. All right, I think we should listen to it.
Yeah.
What do you guys think? Summer Didn't Change a Thing. This is track 6 from the album Friends. Let's have a listen. All right, there we go. How about that one? You like it? Summer Didn't Change a Thing. Yeah. Right? That's what I'm talking about. That's classic White Lies right there.
If there's such a thing as classic White Lies, that's classic White Lies.
That's classic White Lies, I'm telling you. So now we're going to move into something that's very, very, very different than classic White Lies. I would say, when I heard this track, I said to myself, okay, this is really something new and something fresh for you guys as a sound, as a band. In fact, there's like... not really even a bass line to speak of until... it's almost like you did the Prince thing, When Doves Cry, with no real bass line at first until it comes in later, right? This one is called Swing, and it does live up to its name in terms of the drums. I mean, you're playing definitely a different kind of pattern, a little more loose.
The title Swing is a nod to the fact that the rhythm is swung, and originally it was never going to be called Swing, but I don't know what happened. I think we just got bored of trying to think of names for songs, and this was actually a demo name, wasn't it? This was just a song called Swing, but
it was one of those files on the computer of Harry's.
Yeah, exactly.
It was like, yeah, Swing dot 00210.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's why that's what it's called. It's one of my faves, actually. I describe it as basically a patient song, and like White Lies have sort of two main flavors of songs which sort of immediately attack and songs which are slightly more patient, I think. And this song is really, really, it takes a long time to really reach its peak, and I like that. Mm. I really like that. And the peak for me is great, because it's quite a long track, but even when it's reaching the end, I still always feel like I could do with another sort of minute of the outro thing that goes around. For me, it's like the best, probably the best sort of 2 minutes of White Lies music.
Yeah, and I love, I mean, when you talk about the build-up at the end, I love this really, like, I don't know, almost Gary Newman-like synth that comes in that's just really like present in your face, right?
Yeah, I would echo Jack's thoughts on this track. I think the outro to this song is one of the, I feel it's one of our finest achievements in terms of songwriting. I think the melody is beautiful, and I think that more than any other track, for me, I just really don't want it to end. I want it to keep going and going. I think we all have a real emotional investment in this song. We really had to work hard to get it right in the studio, and I think we spent more time on this track than any of the other ones on the album.
Okay.
And it's definitely an album track, but I think it really sums up where we're at as songwriters.
So this is, if there's any track you should really listen to on this album, it would be this one, right?
In my opinion.
Yeah.
This is the one we all collectively enjoy listening to the most. Yeah.
All right, so let's listen to Swing, and let's really like pay attention and check it out.
Whatever.
Yeah. I think this is really, as I said, I think it's really fresh for you guys. It's a new sound, and I think that's really, really cool when a band, like, instead of just doing what they know that they've done before, what their fans expect, but actually push themselves a little bit to explore new boundaries. I think that's always a good thing.
And I would actually add to that that when we first started writing this song, I feel this is very firmly rooted in the Pretenders. I think it has a lot of that aesthetic to it.
Mm.
And I think, especially in the chorus, a lot of the instrumentation really leans towards that. And I'd be really interested to hear whether anyone else picks up on that. I really hear that in this song.
Well, let's check it out. Here we go. Swing from Friends. Track 7 out of 10. We're almost there. Here it comes.
I wake up lonely with love at my side. I wake up lonely and I don't know why.
What do you think? Swing. I like that one. I want to give a shout out to the people in Peru watching this live stream right now, because I'm kind of checking Facebook here. I'm watching. It's so cool. You can see everybody commenting, and we have some viewers from Peru, if you would.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah. We've never played in Peru.
I don't speak any Spanish, so otherwise I would say hola. But we're going to go on now to track 8. This one is called Come On. Yeah, there's like this big anticipation in this song, I think, also, right? There's a moment when it really kicks in. And you have to work hard at the end of the track, because you've got some really fast hi-hat patterns that you have to play, right?
Yeah, but the first
take some stamina.
The first 2 minutes, I don't do fuck all, so it's fine.
So you're ready for it. Right.
This is a hard song to sing. This is a track I think that probably harks back to the first album the most, and I think a lot of people will appreciate that. I think a lot of people will enjoy that. We certainly enjoy it because I don't know. We really felt like we needed a couple of moments like that on the record, and this is one of them. And yeah, I don't know, I only really started to enjoy this song truly when we started to learn how to play it live. And I think it actually, of all the songs on the record, this song perhaps will come across even better live than it does recorded. I hope it does anyway. And I'm really looking forward to playing it on the tour. But yeah, great.
What's the song about?
Put on the spot. Gosh. It's, you know, it's so strange because all of these songs were written like a year ago, you know, and often, and the way that we write, that Harry and I have been writing, at least certainly for this record, and I think probably most of Big TV is we like to work really quite quickly. I remember once this is a bit of exclusive information that actually means nothing because it didn't go anywhere, but Harry and I once did a bit of writing with LaRue, you know, with Ellie from LaRue, and
oh, yeah.
And I remember we were sort of chatting to her when we got to Harry's house, and we were saying, like, you know, how do you want to work?
You were saying, how did you do that hair?
Yeah, saying, how do you want to work? And we said, because what Harry and I usually do is just, like, start the day and just say to yourself that you have to finish a song by the end of it, so, you know, just crack on. And her mind was just so blown by that. I remember her sort of saying, like, how on earth could you write a song in a day? Like, that's insane. You know, it takes me, like, 2 months to write a song. Probably why it took her 3.5 years to put out a second record. But that's how we work. And you know, you end up throwing a lot of stuff away. But because we're working like that, very often we'll spend a couple of hours in the morning coming up with a sort of a rough backing track or, you know, some chords and a rhythm track and whatever else, some nice, like, musical ideas. And then Harry's just kind of like, we need to sing something, so just write anything, write some gibberish. And it's sort of easier said than done, actually, because it's quite hard to, you know, there's lots of stories of I think it's, I know that Bono, there's apparently he just opens books and just grabs whatever he fancies from it. And I remember Ed Bullard always telling that story about Bowie doing, singing, cutting out words from newspapers and patching it all up and just, you know, singing things like that. But I can't really be bothered to do any of that. So when Harry asked for lyrics, I sort of have to sit there and just actually, you know, just try and write something. So because of that, you often and then refine it, you know, and then delete loads of stuff and refine it. But because of that, I often end up writing a song, living with it for a little bit. No one makes any complaints about the lyrics, and so I kind of assume, well, they must be okay. But you don't really think about it until maybe, like now, like you asking me now, so what's this song about? It's kind of having to go, oh, I don't remember because it's a year ago. But in some ways, the kind of feeling of it and the sort of emotional resonance that the words have takes over the actual literal English meaning of them.
So you'll figure
it
out.
It's a song about coming on.
Yeah. You'll figure it out by the end of the song.
By the end of the song, we'll know it, yeah.
Maybe you'll be able to tell us. Okay, let's listen to it.
Yeah.
Shall we listen to it? It's called Come On. Here we go. Track 8.
I'm sick of all the noise from the storm in here. I need a little quiet.
Might have been one of those situations where number one unexpectedly turns into a number two.
Charles is going to interview me now.
Okay. Oh, no, Pablo's back. Oh,
no, I'm back. Come on.
Wait. I think Charles is about to ask me a very revealing question then.
Yeah.
We're about to talk about the worst song on the album.
We have two more tracks left on the album. Yeah. Two more. Did you save the best for last?
I think the next track is interesting. I think there's a couple of things that are quite interesting about the next track. It's called Right Place. This is the first song that we wrote in the writing process for this album. And I think that a lot of this song reflects that. It's certainly the first song we wrote that we felt was good. Mm. And a big inspiration on this song, and I don't know whether it's a good idea to say this, because the verses are incredibly similar. But we listened a lot to Fairy Tale of New York by the Pogues, which is a very famous Christmas song and a song that we love while we were writing the song.
You really love
it. I really love it. Makes me cry all the time. And the
verse. You cry a lot, don't you?
I like to cry.
We all like to have
Yeah, everyone. It's good. It's healthy to cry. Yeah. But right, so this song, Right Place, if you listen out in the verses, you'll hear that. You'll definitely hear that melody from Fairy Tale of New York in there.
Yeah. Definitely, I think. I think it's. I think we just go in a little bit more into the crying about this song because.
I know.
Let's talk about crying a bit more.
Crying in the bathroom.
Yeah. Well, actually, in fact, one thing I will really miss this year is that Harry, most Christmases would have a small drinks party of his close friends, which of course is Jack and I, at his house, and invariably, actually, earlier and earlier each year. Things would just turn to Harry just going, right, everyone, shut up. We're going to listen to Fairy Tale of New York. And let me first of all give you my TED talk about why it's the most beautiful song ever written. And then let me sort of perch on the end of the sofa staring in out the window until the tears are sort of visibly just streaming down his face. clutching a whiskey like that. Just, and then we listen to it two or three times over.
That's a nice image.
Yeah. But this... Like we said earlier, you know, choosing 10 tracks for this album was really, really difficult, and this was kind of like a panic decision at the last minute. I think we had about three songs that were in contention for, I guess, this position, and we felt that this one fit best. But again, you know, we'll collect metadata and see if that was correct.
Well, earlier today, when some of the journalists were coming around, I was speaking to one of them, and he picked this song as his favorite track on the album. So,
Christ.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
I'd actually say as much as I think this track is one of the best sounding tracks on the record. And I think,
that's because it's on Raumfeld speakers tonight.
Well, yeah, of course. But no, we actually, as Charles mentioned, this song was a bit of an afterthought, and actually this song was mixed by our mix engineer's assistant, a woman called Marta Saglioni.
Was it?
Yeah, this is a Marta mix, and I don't know. I think that's another interesting aspect of this track. I don't know if anyone will be able to pick up on that, but this was mixed by someone totally different to the rest of the record, and therefore it has a different flavour to it. It definitely sounds slightly different. So. So it's something to listen out for while you listen to it.
Mm. I think you guys were talking about before that one of the lessons you said you learned from Ed Billow was that like every track needs kind of a atmospheric track where there's like not a lot happening and it's more stripped down. And for me, this one kind of, it was that track, right? It was a bit that way, right?
Yeah, a little bit. I think when we first wrote this song, we maybe and perhaps naively anticipated like opening the record with this, because a lot of records do open with quite sort of slow burning tracks.
Mm.
I think about like Because of the Times, that Kings of Leon record. I think that's our favourite Kings of Leon record, and that opens with a really kind of long, slow building track, and the first Interpol album as well. You know, there's a lot of great albums anyway that do that.
Mm.
We sacked off that idea obviously immediately and opened with a really fast one. But this is definitely this is probably the kind of slowest, most sort of tender ballad on the record.
Are you guys ready for a tender, slow ballad?
Yeah.
Are you ready? Are you ready for a slow jam?
Feel free to kiss.
Okay, well then let's check it out. It's called Right Place. Track number 9 of 10. Here we go.
When does the show start? When does it all get moving?
Yes. Yeah. That felt good. That felt good.
Yeah. We love that track. Yeah. It's good.
Absolutely.
We're about to get on to my favorite track of the record.
Though. I know. You're just itching to talk about it.
Yeah.
It's
definitely.
Called Don't Fall. It's the last track on the album, track number 10, called Don't Fall. When I heard this one, it was, for me, it felt like kind of like an 80s ballad, but without the saxophone. It was a bit like that.
And if one of us had been able to play the saxophone, we'd almost definitely play saxophone on this track.
Where's Kenny G when you need him?
Yeah, but we were talking earlier about the song, and Charles was saying that his girlfriend plays this around the house in earnest.
On Raumfeld speakers.
Yeah, well, maybe.
No.
But I don't know. I feel this song really does transcend White Lies. It's very, very different. But it kind of touches on a lot of what we were listening to when we were making the album. I talked earlier about Steely Dan. And I think this song typifies that Steely Dan sound more than any of the other tracks on the record. It has a real 70s kind of soft rock, almost jazz rock feel to it.
Mm.
And I think the groove and the chorus is some of the most accomplished playing that we've ever managed to put together. And I love this song for that reason. We haven't actually learned how to play this live yet, but we have it ready. And I think that if there's a good response to this track, we will definitely play it on tour.
At Huxley's.
Hopefully. Mm-hmm. If you guys enjoy it, then we'll gather our data today, and then we'll see how.
Works. You guys are really.
But we love this. I don't know if you guys want to say anything about it.
This is my favorite one as well.
I know.
Just to kind of jump on Harry's glory there. Yeah, I love it too, and I find myself almost kind of embarrassed because I often just, I'm like singing it to myself when I'm walking, you know, walking around in a way that, and I'm forgetting that it's a White Lies song, you know, just singing it as I would any song that gets a bit stuck in my head. And, you know, like we've written a bunch of songs over the four albums that have seemingly connected with a lot of people, and that when we play live, you know, they really touch people. And, and songs like Death and Farewell to the Fairground from the first record, and Bigger Than Us, and things like that. The ones that we released as singles, like I'm obviously immensely proud of them, immensely proud of all of them. But this one for me is kind of filed away in a special drawer, like along with First Time Caller from the last record, and with Streetlights from the second record, as almost feeling like it's not us, like we weren't involved with it. It's too good. No, it's a really nice feeling. It's actually so rare that you're able to listen to a piece of your own music and feel kind of distanced from it, and not sort of be critiquing it and going, oh, I can hear myself, and I can hear you know, my lyrics or whatever.
Yeah, you're just hearing
just
it.
Just listen to it, just like a piece of music and enjoying it. And
that's what we're gonna do right now, right?
Yeah, exactly. So yeah. I hope everyone.
This is the last track, Don't Fall. After this track, then we're going to open up the floor for questions and answers with you guys. So if you have some questions for White Lies, you should start thinking about it right now. And then, we'll do a little Q&A. And then we're gonna dance, because White Lies are going to DJ after that. They're going to play some tracks for you that, I don't know, what kind of tracks are you going to play tonight, Charles?
We're just going to play fun music. What I would call fun music.
Okay, fun music. So, do you guys like to have fun? Yeah. I don't know. I like to have fun. Yeah. We're going to have fun. So, let's listen to Don't Fall. This is 3 minutes and 40, what does it say? 43 seconds. 3 minutes and 43 seconds. Don't Fall. Then the Q&A. And then we're going to dance. And then a fun time.
It's like presenting someone with a burger and kind of going, so this is the 9.1 ounces, 9.1 exactly. ounces 3. You've got 40. On your plate here.
Maybe, okay. Does it fade out at the end, or does it just stop?
It stops. We've been very well behaved.
I got to be ready. I got to be ready for that one. Okay, here we go. Don't Fall, track 10. Here we go. Synth bass. Uh-oh. Yeah, sub bass.
Nothing more to say, and nothing more to do.
Hey, how about that? Wow, that was White Lies Friends. You guys are the first people in the world to hear this album in its entirety, so consider yourselves very lucky. The album comes out on Friday, this Friday, just a couple of days. Available on Spotify, iTunes, pretty much everywhere, Amazon. Yeah. You guys have like a picture disc, right? Like vinyl. You did vinyl and cassettes and everything. Like, tell me about that.
There's a few special editions. I think they look great. We're really pleased to own them ourselves. Like, the picture disc looks amazing. It's just so beautiful.
I want one.
Yeah. We all do.
We're giving away a few. Actually, we have some signed copies of the CD that we're going to be giving away on our social media channels this next week. So pay attention to Raumfeld.com, pay attention to our Facebook, and you can get a chance to win a signed copy from all three members of White Lies of the CD Friends, as well as some picture discs, some other nice goodies. So right now I want to open up question and answers from the floor. So if you have a question for White Lies, I'm gonna walk out there and like get into the crowd and get into it and talk to some people. So raise your hand if you have a question for White Lies. I can't really see because these lights are so bright. Who's got a question for the band? Come on, somebody want to ask something. Raise your hands, please. No one has a question for White Lies? Are you kidding? Here we go. All right, what's the question? Tell me. How long have you guys been doing this music stuff? Like, when did you start? Like, for seriously, he wants to know. Like, not as...
What do you mean? Do you mean together?
Yeah.
In the band?
As a band, when you got serious about making music, how long have you been doing this now?
Thinking about it.
We probably started playing in a band together when we were about 14.
How old are you now? Do you mind?
We're 28 now.
28.
So...
All right.
We kind of met when we were in school, and I don't know. It's very hard to say how early on when we were playing together that we thought about doing it seriously. Like, a lot of our early shows were complete disasters. So it takes a very long time to turn that into something that you might think of as a serious career.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's like everything in life.
We were about 18, I think. There was a time where we were meant to go to university, and we all called each other up and said, "Let's not go." And I suppose that's probably a good idea of when.
What did your parents think about that decision, or did you have to argue with them?
They were alarmingly relaxed about it. I mean, yeah, they were fine about it. Really, just they all like music themselves. Sorry, I will hold it. They all really like music themselves. So I think that helped. You know, if they'd been kind of. Yeah, they could relate to the idea of and probably see that we were not completely shit as well at that point, because they've been to a lot of gigs.
We also all have younger brothers and sisters, so they have backup if we failed.
Yeah.
And ironically, we've done all right compared to some of them, so, you know.
All right, next question. Oh, hello.
I have a question relating to that. How much does the music to parents... listen to influence your style making music?
Yeah, what is your parents' taste?
I think a great deal. I think it's very hard to say because you're obviously if your parents listen to music, you're surrounded by it from a very young age. And I definitely always remember even from when I was very young, some of my earliest memories, music being around and music being played in the background or being played during. You know, even when you're eating dinner, certainly when you get in the car, you know, like, I think that if your parents are into music, you're always surrounded by music. And I think that has a huge influence on us, definitely, definitely.
I often feel really kind of tied to what, it was my dad really what he played. And I feel, I often feel like I like all the wrong music. Like, I feel quite guilty sometimes because I have to be honest, like, I'm really not bothered about the Beatles at all. I'm not bothered about Bob Dylan, Oasis, like so many bands that I know are really important to people because of they grew up with it. But in the car, which was how I listened to music being young with cassette tapes, my dad would just have a load of cassette tapes in the glove compartment or whatever, and so, you know, I get to pick. And I think the only ones that were in English, he had a really substantial collection of Brazilian music, so I guess I listened to a lot of Brazilian music, which I still really enjoy, but the ones that were in English and kind of mainstream were, he had a Paul Simon greatest hit, so for me, Paul Simon is means to me what I guess David Bowie and Prince and whatever mean to other people, like he's my kind of songwriting number one. And also, he had some weird things. Crowded House. I actually still really like Crowded House. You know, what else did he have in the car? I forget. And then my mum would have like Gloria Estefan. You guys know her. We'd had a lot of that, and I remember being in the back of the car and distinctly knowing that I did not like that. some notes held for like the distance between London and Scotland. Like just a whole note she could hold. And I was just like, shut the fuck up. But yeah, I do sometimes feel like I've had quite a weird musical upbringing in terms of what I was exposed to. And perhaps someday I will really sit down and try and get into all the kind of those great artists that most people count as like, oh, obviously, you know, I like them. But no, not at the moment.
All right, more questions. Who's got a question?
That was a good
for
question.
White Lies? That was a good question. Interesting.
There's one go. That. Okay. Just saying, there's one over there, but it's a. We get
Hello.
Some.
Hi. I want to know who is responsible or who has the ideas for your extraordinary music videos, like Strangers or yeah. Take It Out of Me?
I tell you what, to be honest with you, I absolutely hate music videos so much. They're so boring to film usually, like you have to wait around all the time. And we've done in the past ones where we've tried to kind of like mime and perform in them. And I think it's such a strange format that obviously was so important when it first came out in the 80s. It was this really new thing, and what a great way to promote and sell music. But now with all the other ways that people listen to music, and I remember us being 14, 15 years old and going, we had one friend where we grew up who had like cable TV. He was like the only one that had that. So he had MTV and MTV2 when that came out, and when we were all into rock music. And we would happily go and just sit for 4 hours just watching MTV2 and just drinking beer and just watching songs on repeat. It was great. But I don't think anybody does that anymore. So we kind of feel with our music videos now, like, we might as well just have fun, you know. There's no point trying to do anything. I would stress that even though some people have kind of looked at them and gone, oh, you know, it's so, like, arty and wanky. Like, that's really not what we're trying to do. We're just really trying to have a lot of fun and work, collaborate with directors who we can kind of give them a lot more resources and, you know, to kind of fulfill their own inspiration and vision than perhaps they might usually have. And the first three videos that we did on the first record with a guy called Andreas Nilsson, he had only really recently like graduated from art school a couple of years before, and he'd done like one animation video before them. And then he made three of our, well, probably the three best videos that we've ever made. And he's now earning just millions of pounds directing like Audi car adverts and stuff. So, you know, really good for him.
All right, we have a question for the internets. Good end. Oh, wait, you want to add something?
Oh, no, go on.
Okay, question for the internets.
Okay.
Oh. What song would you like to cover and why?
Ooh, good question.
Can we all answer this individually?
Yeah.
Sure, why not?
And that'd be more fun. I've wanted for a very long time, and I don't really know why, but to cover Lola by The Kinks, because I think it's a great track. And I think lyrically it's very interesting, and I think set in the context historically, like what people were writing about at the time that song was written, it's even more interesting. And also I think it's a fantastic piece of rock music. So I don't know. I don't know if White Lies would ever be able to do a good version of that song, but I've always sort of fantasized about covering that track. I've always been a big fan of it.
Have you got one?
I was going to say that it would be really fun for us to reattempt covering Psycho Killer, it having been the first song that we learned. And Harry also still being the same level of French. There's a French verse in that song, which Harry used to just literally make vowel sounds through the whole like that. It would be fun to do that again. It's still a song that actually sort of I listen to for fun. And I'm pretty sure we could do a better version than the version we attempted 10 years ago, guys. Maybe we should do that. Yeah. Go on, Charles.
I like the idea of... I think one thing I feel with a lot of new music these days compared to a lot of music that I listen to from the 70s or 80s is that somewhat of a kind of tasteful flamboyancy of how good you are at playing has kind of gone down a bit. And sometimes that's really great. I mean, no one wants 20-minute guitar solos. But I also think that there's room for a few bands to be... No, it's not that out there. There's room for a few bands to be kind of, you know, playing other than metal bands, because obviously all metal bands are fucking great at playing their instruments. To be doing some more kind of like progressive stuff where you have to be actually really shit hot at what you're playing. So for that reason, I think a good mix of kind of pop and rock and prog, I suppose, is War Pigs by Black Sabbath. I think it'd be so fun to learn that, and to say, like, you know, you have to learn the guitar solos like note for note, really properly, learn all the fills. I think it's a good thing for a band to do, to actually learn a complicated 8-minute piece of music. It'd be a good exercise.
All right, we have time for one more question, and then we're gonna give you guys a chance to like meet the band. You can get some autographs, stuff like that, and then we're gonna start the DJ set within a few minutes. And yeah, so one more question. You have one right here. Hello. What do you want to know?
What are your travel essentials when you go on tour?
What are your travel essentials when you go on tour? What do you need?
That's a great question.
That is a good question. I'm interested in that.
I think I always find myself traveling with an enormous amount of books, and I always pack way more than I need. And I never end up reading them. I only ever read half a book when I'm away, but I always take like 6 or 7 books with me, and real books as well. I don't know why, but that's an essential for me. I always travel everywhere with a book. But outside of that, it's the normal things. Earplugs are great if you're on a plane. A nice pair of headphones, a good iPod, nice music. I don't know. Like I've never got into those sort of neck pillows. You see a lot of people wearing them. I don't know. Do you think we should? I mean, maybe we should give those a go. I don't know if anyone in the audience have experience of those neck pillows and whether actually work. We could collect data for the neck pillows. Yeah. But how about you guys?
Travel essentials. I just think you never can have enough socks. Oh, and swimming trunks.
Wherever you go.
I mean, you will not believe.
You never know where you're
going. You will not believe the amount of times that we've got somewhere really unexpected. I don't know, like a house. Or even just a bar or something, and someone goes, I hope you guys have your swimming trunks, because there's a volleyball team bathing in a jacuzzi outside or something. It happens all the time. But it is good to have swimming trunks, because a bit of R&R on a day off can often involve wet activity.
Oh.
When you forget them, everyone else is a great.
And when everyone else has got them, and then what happens is you're in a hotel and there's a swimming pool and everyone else is swimming in their swimming trunks and you're sat there thinking, well, I could go in my pants, but I know everything that's going to happen if I do that. I know how this is going to look. I know what this fabric does to the contours of my groin, and you have to sort of weigh it up, and it just. Just seriously, like, people carry a lot around with them that they really don't need, but swimming trunks, you just bring them. I mean, you should have them here.
Speedos or
you should have them
trunks?
Here. Because what if right now we said to you, hey, we've actually, this was a hotel that we're staying in has got a volleyball team bathing in a jacuzzi around the corner and everyone's invited. You guys would be stuffed.
Jack.
I was just remembering the time that Harry most recently forgot his swimming trunks, which was on my stag do.
Oh.
I've got some pictures. I won't show them. My travel essentials, I don't know. I need Harry and Charles, otherwise I'm just a drummer on a tour bus, which no one needs to see. I take my phone everywhere, and I'm very good at... I save locations. If I go anywhere that I enjoy, I star it on Google Maps so that I know that next time I go to that city, I've got somewhere... that's fun to go. And that's become a real hobby of mine. So every city that we go to in Europe, I'll have like 3 or 4 places which I consider to have like good coffee, medium to strong strength, Wi-Fi, like all the essentials really. And that's all I need. My phone, it's got everything in it.
Brilliant. All right, so I wanna thank everyone here for coming out tonight. It's not over. It's not over by the, not at all.
I mean,
no. So, you guys can stick around for a little bit. You can meet the band. Hello, say hello, chit-chat, get some autographs. And then these guys are going to DJ for you, so you can hang out and listen to some music from White Lies DJ set exclusively here at Teufel Raumfeld store. So, give it up for White Lies. Please say thank you for, premiering the album. Thank you all for coming, yes. So, right, we're going to clear the stage. We're going to bring the DJ booth out, and then the music starts, and... You guys should get some more beer and keep drinking and enjoy yourselves. Thank you.